Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 27th March 2021. These are the list of news articles chosen for today's discussion. They are given along with the page numbers of different editions and also the link for the handwritten notes in PDF format and the time stamping for the discussed articles are provided in the description box as well as in the comment section for the benefit of mobile phone users. Now let us move on to the analysis of the first news article. This article is about the controversy surrounding the appointment of Chief Justice of India. See, the Chief Justice of India, Sharad A. Bobde, has recommended Justice N.V. Ramana as the next Chief Justice of India. Now, this recommendation is widely criticized because of a complaint that was filed by the Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh against Justice Ramana last year. Now, in this context, let us discuss the office of the Chief Minister. The syllabus covered by this news article is highlighted below for your reference. See, in the parliamentary system of government, the governor is the nominal executive authority and the chief minister is the real executive authority. Or in other words, you can say that the governor is the head of the state while the chief minister is the head of the government. Thus, the position of the chief minister at the state level is similar or is comparable to the position which the prime minister enjoys at the level of the center. Now, let's see about the appointment of chief minister. Now, when it comes to the appointment of the chief minister, the constitution does not contain any specific procedure. See, Article 164 of the constitution only says that the chief minister shall be appointed by the governor. However, this does not imply that the governor is free to appoint anyone as the chief minister. If you see, in accordance with the convention of the parliamentary system of government, the governor has to appoint the leader of the majority party in the state legislative assembly as the chief minister. But when no party has a clear majority in the assembly, then the governor may exercise his personal discretion in the selection and appointment of the chief minister. At such a situation, the governor usually appoints the leader of the largest party or coalition in the assembly as the chief minister and will ask him or her to seek a vote of confidence in the house within a month. Similarly, the governor may have to exercise his individual judgment in the selection and appointment of the chief minister when the chief minister in office dies suddenly and there is no obvious successor. However, on the death of a chief minister, the ruling party usually elects a new leader and the governor has no choice but to appoint him as the chief minister. The constitution does not require the person to prove his or her majority in the legislative assembly before he or she is appointed as the chief minister. That is, the governor may first appoint the chief minister and then ask him or her to prove their majority in the legislative assembly within reasonable time period. Note, a person who is not a member of the state legislature can be appointed as the chief minister for a period of 6 months, within which time he or she should be elected to the state legislature. And if they fail to do so, then they will cease to be the chief minister. According to the constitution, the chief minister may be a member of any of the two houses of a legislature. However, usually chief ministers have been selected from the lower house of the legislative assembly. But on a number of occasions, a member of the upper house or the legislative council has also been appointed as the chief minister. On talking about the tenure of the chief minister, theoretically, the chief minister holds office during the pleasure of the governor. However, in actual practice, the chief minister remains in office so long as he or she continues to be the leader of the majority in the state legislative assembly, and the governor can dismiss the chief minister in cases where he or she loses the majority support. And also, the state legislative assembly can remove the chief minister by passing a vote of no confidence against them. On coming to the powers of the chief minister, see, the chief minister is the head of the council of ministers and they will aid and advise the governor on important issues. And they will also communicate to the governor all the decisions of the council of ministers relating to the administrative matters of the state. And further, the chief minister is the leader of the house and all the policies are announced by them on the floor of the house. Further, the chief minister also recommends dissolution of the legislative assembly to the governor. In addition to that, he or she also advises the governor regarding the summoning or proroguing the sessions of state legislative assembly from time to time. Now, let's move on to the next news article. Now look at this editorial article titled Dormant Parliament, Failing Business. This article covers the functioning trend of the parliament in the recent past, or in other words, the declining function of the central legislature is the essence of the article. The author here discusses the article in the light of premature closure of the budget session due to the poll schedules across India. The syllabus relevant for this news article is highlighted below for your reference. First, let us look into why the author considers the parliamentary functions to be fading. First comes the shrinking session durations. Now, this trend is visible not just in the budget session that just concluded, but also during the previous year, that is in 2020. See, in 2020, the Lok Sabha sat only for 33 days, which was the lowest ever in history. However, the author notes that COVID cannot be cited as a sole reason for this, since there are online methods that could have been adopted, which India conveniently passed by. Now, next comes the decline in the scrutiny of bills. We all know that Parliament is a legislative body and that the statutes originating here are not merely subject of debates by the members. That is, during the second reading, the bill can be referred to parliamentary committees. See, parliamentary committees like Standing Committee, Select Committee and Joint Committees are apparatuses that scrutinize the bill in expert capacity. Now, even though referring to parliamentary committees is a time-consuming process, still it plays an important role when it comes in preventing the executive from taking any hasty decision. That is, it reinforces the function of the parliament, or in simple words, parliament's function of check on the executive is done properly. Now, if you look at the budgetary session of this year, 13 bills were introduced, but none of them were referred to the committees. And many controversial, contentious bills were passed without proper deliberations. Now, for your better understanding, have a look at the table. See, the Government of National Capital Territory of Delhi Amendment Bill 2021, which is related to the governance mechanism of Delhi and with the entrusting of LG with more powers, was introduced and passed in both the houses in 90s. And the Mines and Minerals Development and Regulation Amendment Bill, which deals with the removal of end-use restrictions on mines and easing of conditions for captive mines, took less than a week to be introduced and passed in both the houses. Similarly, the NBFID Bill of 2021 to create new government infrastructure finance institution and to permit private ones in the sector also took just 3 days to get introduced and passed at both the houses, and the Insurance Amendment Bill, which aims to increase the limit of foreign direct investment in insurance companies from 49% to 74%, was passed in just 7 days at both the houses. Now, as you can see, all are high-impact bills. That is, these bills have got high political and social repercussions. Now, at such a case, referring them to parliamentary committees could actually minimize the controversies, and it will also help in improving the quality of the statute. Now, for example, the parliamentary committee examined the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, and it suggested many changes to make the code work better. And all these suggested changes were incorporated in the final law, and at present it is one of the most successful pieces of statute. Now, next comes the issue with the classification of a bill as a money bill. Now, we all know that the decision on a bill, whether it should be a money bill or not, lies with the Speaker of the House. Now, this provision is said to be misused by the Parliament to circumvent the Rajya Sabha, because as we know, Rajya Sabha does not have a say on the money bill. Now, here you can recollect the Aadhaar Act in this context. Now, on moving further, even the budget is said to have been passed without much discussion in the past 15 years. And the author opines that in the trend observed in the last 15 years, around 70-100% of the budget have been passed without discussion in most of the years. Now, this lack of proper discussion has diluted the parliamentary checks on the executive expenditure. Another important aspect is that there has been a missing deputy speaker. Now, remember, Article 93 provides for us for an elected deputy speaker, and this deputy speaker will take over in the absence of the speaker. Know that the current Lok Sabha doesn't have a deputy speaker. Now, this hampers the function of the parliament in the absence of the speaker. However, all this is not a new phenomenon, and those in power have used the loopholes in the parliament functioning to further fulfill the agenda. And in 2008, in order to avoid an initiation or no confidence motion, the government extended the monsoon session until Christmas. Now, you should note that more than one no confidence motion cannot be initiated in a session. Now, in this light, having all these issues in mind, the author says that Parliament has been increasingly fading in its functioning. And he further suggests for a creation of an expert research team to support the MPs as a way to improve the quality of the bills, and also about the need for the legislators to be cognizant about the hasty decisions and to slow down in the way ahead. With this information, now let's move on to the next news article. Now, this news article is with reference to Aadhaar. Remember, yesterday we had discussed about Unique Identification Authority of India and Aadhaar card. Now, today's news talks about a direction that was issued by the Madras High Court to the UIDAI to ascertain immediately if Aadhaar data of citizens had been compromised. Now, this direction comes at the backdrop of allegations from a public interest litigant. And the litigant alleged that the Puducherry unit of a political party had been able to access mobile numbers of voters from the UIDAI database. So in this context, let's have an elaborate understanding about Aadhaar, its benefits, and also the issues associated with it. The syllabus covered by this news is given below. See, as we know, Aadhaar number is a 12-digit random number that is issued by UIDAI to the residents of India after satisfying the verification process. Here, the Unique Identification Authority of India is a statutory authority that was established under the provisions of the Aadhaar Targeted Delivery of Financial and Other Subsidies, Benefits and Services Act of 2016, which comes under the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. Know that any individual, irrespective of age and gender, who is a resident of India may voluntarily enroll to obtain this Aadhaar number, and a person who is willing to enroll has to provide minimal demographic and biometric information during the enrollment process. Now here, demographic information is nothing but the details related to the person, such as name, date of birth or age, then gender, address, mobile number and email ID, etc. And in the biometric information, see, biometric means the physical or behavioral human characteristics of a person that can be used to digitally identify a person. So biometric information constitutes fingerprints of the 10 fingers, 2 iris scans and also a facial photograph. Know that an individual needs to enroll for Aadhaar only once. Now this is because Aadhaar is a unique number that is allocated to the individuals, and this number cannot be duplicated, as no two persons will have the same biometrics. And also the enrolling process is totally free of cost. Now with this information, let us now see as to what are the benefits of this Aadhaar. See, first and foremost, it is unique and robust enough to eliminate the duplicates or fake identities. Secondly, Aadhaar can be used as a basis or a primary identifier to roll out several government welfare schemes and programs. And this will ensure effective service delivery. Then as a result, it will promote transparency and good governance. Note, this is the only program of its kind globally, and the state of the art, that is the ultra modern digital and online ID, is being provided free of cost at such a large scale to people. So we can say that Aadhaar has got the potential to change the way service delivery functions in our country. Thirdly, remember that Aadhaar number does not have any intelligence, and it does not profile or describe people based on caste, religion, income, health, geography or any such demarcations. Remember, the Aadhaar number is just a proof of identity. Now, what we have to note here is that it does not confer any right of citizenship or domicile in respect of an Aadhaar number holder. Fourth, the Aadhaar identity platform enables the government to directly deliver various subsidies, benefits and services just by using the Aadhaar number. Now, this becomes possible with its inherent features of uniqueness, authentication, financial address and also the KYC norms. Fifthly, the government says that Aadhaar is a strategic policy tool for social and financial inclusion as well as for public sector delivery reforms. And adding to this, it is also a tool for managing the fiscal budgets to increase convenience and also to promote the hassle-free people-centric governance. Now, having done with all these positive, now let's look into the concerns that is related to the Aadhaar. Now, the first concern is identity theft. See, Aadhaar is vulnerable to illegal harvesting of biometrics as well as identity frauds because biometrics are not a secret information. And moreover, possible leakage of biometric and demographic data either from the central Aadhaar repository or from a point of sale or from an enrollment device adds to the risk. The second issue is with respect to the identification without the consent using Aadhaar data. Now, there may be unauthorized use of biometrics to identify people illegally, and such violations may include identifying people by inappropriate matching of fingerprint or iris scans or even the facial photographs that is stored in the Aadhaar database. Now, the third issue is the correlation of identities across domains. Now, it may become possible to track an individual's activities across multiple domains of service using their Aadhaar IDs, which are valid across all these domains. And this has got the potential to lead to the identification without consent. Another issue is with respect to the illegal tracking of individuals, wherein individuals may be tracked or put under surveillance without proper authorization or legal sanction using the Aadhaar database. So in this regard, we should remember that the Aadhaar scheme was challenged before the Supreme Court by Justice K.S. Puttaswamy, and he claims that Aadhaar infringes upon the fundamental rights guaranteed by the Constitution. And this resulted in the famous Aadhaar verdict that was pronounced by the Supreme Court in the year 2018. While it ruled that the Aadhaar Act of 2016 is constitutional, the verdict struck down some of the individual sections of the Act to be unconstitutional, and subsequently the Aadhaar and Other Laws Amendment Bill of 2019 was passed by the Parliament in 2019. And this amendment allowed voluntary use of Aadhaar as a proof of identity for users for services like opening bank accounts and also for getting a mobile phone connection. With this, we have come to the end of this news discussion. Let's move on to the next news article. Now look at this article. This article is regarding the India-US relationship from trade perspective. The article says that India and the United States have agreed to work constructively to resolve the key outstanding bilateral trade issues. See, both countries committed themselves to strengthen the cooperation on shared objectives and also to revitalize engagement through the US-India Trade Policy Forum. See, India and the US have difference of opinions over several issues such as digital trade, intellectual property, agriculture, labor, climate and environment. And such issues are expected to be resolved in the coming days. The article says that United States Trade Representative and India's Union Minister for Commerce and Industry agreed to hold the next ministerial level meeting of the Trade Policy Forum during 2021. So in this context, let us discuss in brief about the India-US relations, particularly about the high-level dialogue mechanism. See, India and the United States have more than 50 bilateral intergovernmental dialogue mechanisms for exchange of views on issues of mutual interest. And a number of such dialogue mechanisms are held at the ministerial level. So now let us see them in brief. The first one is the India-US 2+2 Ministerial Dialogue. See, the India-US 2+2 Ministerial Dialogue is led by the heads of foreign and defense ministries of both India and US. Now, so far, three rounds of this dialogue have been held in the years 2018, 19 and 2020 respectively. Now, next comes the India-US Commercial Dialogue, which is led by the Ministry of Commerce and Industry and the US Secretary of Commerce, which was held in Delhi in February 2019. Third comes the India-US Economic and Financial Partnership. Know that the India-US Economic and Financial Partnership is led by the Indian Finance Minister and the US Secretary of the Treasury. And this partnership was last held in Delhi during November 2019. Another high-level dialogue mechanism which was discussed today is the India-US Trade Policy Forum, which is led by the Ministry of Commerce and Industry and the US Trade Representative. Now, this was last held in Washington, D.C. in October 2007, before the latest meeting. Another important mechanism is the India-US Strategic Energy Partnership. Know that the India-US Strategic Energy Partnership is led by the Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas and the US Secretary of Energy. This Strategic Energy Partnership was last held in Delhi in April 2018. And the India-US Homeland Security Dialogue is another such mechanism, which is led by the Ministry of Home Affairs and the Secretary of the US Department of Homeland Security. With this, we have come to the end of discussion of this topic. Let's see what the next article is about. This news article is related to the visit of the Indian Prime Minister to Bangladesh as a part of its National Day celebrations. So during his visit, our Prime Minister paid tribute to the freedom fighters and also the Indian soldiers who were martyred in the War of Liberation that happened in 1971. So in this context, let's discuss in brief about the 1971 war and also about India-Bangladesh relations since then. The syllabus covered by this news is given below for your reference. Know that the Bangladesh Liberation War of 1971 was fought for the independence of Bangladesh, or the former East Pakistan, from Pakistan. After the partition in 1947, the capital of Pakistan, that is Karachi, which was in West Pakistan, was moved to Islamabad in 1958. And on March 26th of 1971, people in East Pakistan, they declared independence under Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, who is the father of present Bangladesh Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina. A kind reminder, the important reasons for this war have been elaborately explained in our 24th February analysis, so we advise you to watch it for a better understanding. Coming back, see, we must know that India had played an important role in the independence of Bangladesh, because during the war, India gave shelter to the refugees and it also trained the Mukti Bahini, who are the Bengali freedom fighters. And finally, on 16th of December in the year 1971, Dhaka fell to the Mitra Bahini, which is the elite forces of the Mukti Bahini and the Indian Army. So that is why December 16 is recognized as the Victory Day in Bangladesh and March 26th is recognized as the Independence Day. Now let us discuss the bilateral relationship between India and Bangladesh. See, India was the first country to recognize Bangladesh as a separate and independent state, and it also established diplomatic relations with the country soon after its independence in the year 1971. The relationship between India and Bangladesh is not only evident from its history, but it is also visible in the culture, language and shared values of secularism and democracy. Know that there are more than 50 bilateral institutional mechanisms between India and Bangladesh, which covers areas like security, trade and commerce, then power and energy, and also transport and connectivity, science and technology, defense, rivers and maritime affairs, etc. Now, coming to the border management, India and Bangladesh share around 4,096.7 km of border, which is the longest land boundary that India shares with any of its neighbors. I'll again repeat, India shares the longest land boundary with Bangladesh than with any of its neighbors. And the India-Bangladesh Land Boundary Agreement came into force in the year 2015. Following this, the enclaves of India and Bangladesh in each other's country were exchanged. Now, apart from this, the settlement of the maritime boundary arbitration between India and Bangladesh in the year 2014 paved way for the economic development of this part of the Bay of Bengal, and this was done as per the United Nations Convention for the Law of the Sea, or which is also called as UNCLOS Award. Another remarkable area in India-Bangladesh relations is the sharing of river waters. We know that India and Bangladesh share around 54 common rivers, and a bilateral joint river commission is working since 1972 to maximize the benefits from these common river systems. And another significant development is the Ganga Waters Treaty, which was signed in 1996 for the sharing of waters from River Ganga during lean season, which is generally from January 1 to May 31st. Coming to the economic relations, Bangladesh is India's biggest trade partner in South Asia, and bilateral trade between India and Bangladesh is found to have grown steadily over the last decade. For example, India's exports to Bangladesh in the financial year 2018-19 stood at $9.21 billion, and imports from Bangladesh during the same period was around $1.4 billion. Note that the cooperation in power sector has become one of the hallmarks of India-Bangladesh relations, and this is evident with Bangladesh currently importing to around 1,160 megawatt of power from India. Finally, know that Bangladesh is the biggest development partner of India at present, and India has extended 3 lines of credits to Bangladesh in the last 8 years, and this amounts to around $8 billion. And this 3 lines of credit is mainly for the sake of development of infrastructure in various sectors. And also, Government of India has also been providing grant assistance to Bangladesh for various other infrastructure projects as well. And this includes construction of Akhaura Agartala rail link, the dredging of inland waterways in Bangladesh, and also the construction of India-Bangladesh friendship pipeline. With this information, let's move on to the next news article. Now, this news article talks about the Gujarat government's plan to introduce a bill called as the Gujarat Freedom of Religion Amendment Bill in its legislature. And this bill seeks to penalize forcible or fraudulent religious conversion by marriage. Remember, recently we had heard about the UP government and the MP government coming up with ordinances which are popularly known as the Law on Love Jihad, and also many other states hinted at creating a new law against this love jihad. So in this context, let's have a brief understanding about love jihad, and then we will also see the important provisions of the said bill. See, love jihad or Romeo jihad is a term that is used to describe an imaginary criminal conspiracy by Muslim men aimed at forcibly converting vulnerable Hindu women to Islam through trickery and marriage. See, it is a kind of Islamophobic conspiracy theory alleging that Muslim men target women belonging to non-Muslim communities for conversion to Islam by pretending love. Remember, the claims of widespread conversions have spread throughout India and beyond, but in most of the cases, no element of love jihad could be found by the investigation agencies. Now, let's see in brief about the bill. As per the information from government sources, the bill will be presented in the ongoing budget session of state government, and it seeks to amend the Gujarat Freedom of Religion Act of 2003. See, this 2003 Act deals with religious conversion through allurement, force, or by misrepresentation, or by any other fraudulent means. Now, as per its statement of object, the bill seeks to curb the emerging trend in which women are lured to marriage for the purpose of religious conversion. Now, let's see some of the important provisions of the bill. First, the bill defines allurement as also promising better lifestyle, divine blessings or otherwise. Next, the forcible conversion by marriage or by getting a person married in a forced manner will invite imprisonment of about 3 to 5 years and up to 2 lakh fine. Moreover, if the woman is a minor or a woman or a Dalit or a tribal, then the offenders may be punished with a jail term of around 4 to 7 years and a fine of not less than 3 lakh rupees. Further, if any organization is found violating the law, then the person in charge can be sentenced to between 3 years to 10 years in jail, and a fine of up to 5 lakh can be imposed. Next, marriages solemnized for the purpose of religious conversion will be declared void, and also the burden of proof shall lie on the accused. As per the bill, the parents, siblings, and any other person who is related by blood, marriage, or adoption to the victim can lodge a complaint to the authority. Additionally, know that the offenses under the bill will be non-bailable. So these are some of the provisions with respect to the said bill. This article is about the fire that engulfed a private hospital in Mumbai. As per reports, at least 9 people, including infants, died in this accident. With this article in context, let's discuss about fire safety. The syllabus relevant for this news is highlighted below for your reference. Now, before going into fire safety, let's have a look at the risks associated with fire. See, fires happen due to human activities or from natural causes. And when you take forest fires, it can start from either natural causes or human activity, or also from a combination of both. But however, the most common fires are the residential and non-residential structural fires. And these fires are usually caused by human errors, faulty designs, and also by mechanical failures. See, when you take cities, we have a lot of high-rise buildings. And among others, it is these high-rise buildings which are more prone to fire accidents because they lack an adequate inbuilt fire protection system. And this lacking makes rescue operations difficult. And also the safety norms and the standardization rules are found to be violated when it comes to the construction of such buildings. And these are some of the major causes of fire accidents. Say for example, large-scale construction of false roofs in commercial buildings and multiplexes is against the law. But this rule is heavily violated as we can see them to be used in practice. And also, many places have a poor storage system. See, this poor storage system can become a problem because poorly stored goods help in further spreading the fire. And it will also prevent or it will also hinder the firefighters from gaining access to the fire hotspot. And it will also reduce the effectiveness of the sprinkler systems. In addition to these issues, we lack adequate resources, preparedness, and also the poor fire services when it comes to handling these fire accidents. So, in order to overcome these hurdles, the National Disaster Management Plan has given certain infrastructural and systematic recommendations to reduce the risk of deadly fires. See, this National Disaster Management Plan was released in the year 2016 and it aims to make India disaster resilient and it also aims to reduce the loss of lives and assets in a significant manner. And this plan covers all phases of disaster management like that of prevention, mitigation, response as well as recovery. Now, according to this plan, the growth of fire services in the country has been slow. And it definitely needs to be professionalized. And also there is a considerable need to upgrade the skills of the staff and to modernize the entire fire service system. So to achieve all these, the government should increase the financial support and assistance in augmenting and modernizing the fire departments. Note, proper designing of electrical fittings and regular maintenance of wiring at least once in a year can reduce the risk of fire in a significant manner. So therefore, building awareness among citizens about this fire prevention is also a key in this fight. And this can be done by organizing a firefighting workshop once in 6 months in localities and schools. And regular inspection of critical fire-prone installations at high-rise buildings and also in places like multiplexes in congested areas by the fire service departments can minimize these accidents to a greater extent. In addition to all these, measures like proper demarcation of entry and exit points in crowded buildings, then the installation of firefighting equipment and their regular maintenance, and also periodic inspections can facilitate our cause. See, when you take the case of hospital fires, they are a totally distant entity when it comes to fire safety. Because the presence of incapacitated patients, then the oxygen-filled environments, the plenty of air conditioning, and also the lack of sufficient physical space creates a totally devastating combination when fire strikes. So that is the reason why such critical situations require strong and extra measures to counter them. So therefore, some of the measures that can be proposed for hospital fires can be the availability of open space to move patients during an emergency, the assessment of the quality of infrastructure and electrical installations, the retrofitting of structures with flame retardant materials, and triaging of patients can play a prominent role. See, the triaging of patients means to decide the order of the treatment of patients. This can be helpful because it can reduce the crowding in hospital. So in this regard, the scientifically designed public health facilities seems to be a key in reducing hospital fires. Now let's move on to the next news article. We all are aware of Brazil being in news for its numerous deaths due to COVID. So in this context, let's have a glimpse on the geography of Brazil. See, Brazil is a country of South America that occupies half the continent's landmass. And the capital city of Brazil is Brasilia, which is a master plan city that was built back in late 1950s. Note, it is the fifth largest country in the world and it stretches roughly to around 4,350 kilometers from north to south and from east to west to form a vast irregular triangle. Remember, Brazil faces the Atlantic Ocean and it shares inland borders with every South American countries except Chile and Ecuador. Now let's look at its land borders. See, Brazil has got Uruguay, Argentina, Paraguay and Bolivia to its south, Peru to its west, Colombia to its northwest, and Venezuela, Guyana, Suriname and French Guyana to its north. Due to its vast geographical extent, a wide range of tropical as well as subtropical landscapes including wetlands, savannas, plateaus and low mountains are found to exist in Brazil. It is to be noted that there is little seismic or volcanic activity due to Brazil's position near the center of the South American plate. Remember, Brazil contains most of the Amazon River Basin, which is the world's largest river system as well as the world's most extensive rainforest. And this country contains no desert or high mountain or any Arctic environment as such. Since both Ecuador and Capricorn passes through Brazil, the climate is predominantly tropical. And also, Brazil usually has a humid tropical and subtropical climate except for a drier area in the northeast. And this area is sometimes called the drought quadrilateral or the drought polygon. Remember, in Brazil, the rains occur predominantly in the summer season. Let us now move on to the practice question discussion. Consider the following statements. Constitution does not contain any specific procedure for the appointment of chief minister. Person who is not a member of state legislature cannot be appointed as chief minister. Which of the above statements is or are correct? See, the first statement is correct because the constitution does not contain any specific procedure related to the appointment of the chief minister. When you look at the second statement, this is incorrect because a person who is not a member of the state legislature can be appointed as the chief minister for a period of 6 months. And since the question wants us to identify the correct statement, the right option is option A, that is one only. Consider the following statements with reference to the Special Marriage Act of 1954. Statement 1, it allows solemnization of marriages without going through any religious customs or rituals. Statement 2, according to the Act, both bride and groom must be a minimum of 21 years old to be legally eligible to get married. So which of the above statements is or are correct? So as we know, the Special Marriages Act of 1954 is an act of the Parliament which allows solemnization of marriages without going through any religious customs or rituals. And people from different castes or religions or even states get married in which marriage is solemnized by way of registration. Now the objective of this Special Marriage Act is to address the interreligious marriages and to establish marriage as a secular institution lacking all religious formalities other than the registration. But however, this Special Marriage Act has put forward certain conditions, like both the parties that are involved to get married should not have any other subsisting valid marriage, and the groom must be a minimum of 21 years and the bride should be a minimum of 18 years old, and also the party should be competent in reference to their mental capacity to the extent that they are able to give valid consent for the marriage, and also the party shouldn't fall within the degrees of prohibited relationship. So based on these conditions, we can say that statement 2 is incorrect because the groom must be a minimum of 21 years old and the bride must be a minimum of 18 years old. Okay, but here in the statement it's given as both the bride and groom must be a minimum of 21 years, which is incorrect. So since the question wants us to identify the correct statement, the right option is option A, that is one only. Consider the following statements with reference to Aadhaar. Statement 1, the Aadhaar identity card confers right of citizenship and domicile to an Aadhaar number holder. And statement 2, Aadhaar platform works as a strategic policy tool of Government of India for social and financial inclusion and public sector delivery norms. The question wants us to identify the correct statement. When you look at statement 1, you can find that it is incorrect because, as seen in the discussion, the Aadhaar number does not have any intelligence and it does not profile or describe people based on caste, religion, income, health and geography. And also, the Aadhaar number is just a proof of identity, and we should remember that it does not confer any right of citizenship or domicile in respect of an Aadhaar number holder. So therefore, this statement is incorrect. Now coming to the second statement, it is correct because Aadhaar platform works as a strategic policy tool of the Government for social and financial inclusion and also for public sector delivery norms. And since the question asks for the correct answer, the right option is option B, that is 2 only. Look at this question. Which of the following countries doesn't border Brazil? If you remember, we saw in the discussion that Brazil is a country that bases the Atlantic Ocean and it shares inland borders with every South American countries except for Chile and Ecuador. So based on that explanation, you can easily eliminate the wrong options, which are nothing but Ecuador and Chile. And therefore, the right answer is option A, that is 1 and 6 only. The list of mains practice questions is displayed here. You can write your answer and post them in the comment section below. With this, we have come to the end of today's Indo News analysis. If you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates regarding UPSC Civil Services preparation.